So today I'm going to pay homage to this guy on my shirt, Harry Sparnai. Harry was my mentor and teacher back in Amsterdam in 1989 and 1990 when I was studying with him. And he just passed away December 12th. He was 73. And if you don't know Harry, you need to go find out more about him. He is probably, for me, the most important bass clarinet player that has ever lived. Of course, there are some arguments that could be made about this guy, Eric Dolphy, but for me, like I said, Harry, he was my teacher, he was my mentor, he was very important to me. And so when he passed away, I was, understandably in shock. And I wanted to play something in honor of him, so I picked this piece, which is Sprezzatura by Huss Janssen, a Dutch composer, and it was written in 1985, so just a few years before I got there. And it was written for Harry, and it was one of the first pieces I learned, and it was totally foreign to me. It uses a lot of multiphonics, which we're going to talk about after I play it. But first, Sprezzatura is defined here as perfect manners combined with ease and naturalness of bearing. That's what the composer writes. And here, this is my favorite part. It's indicative of the person's disdain or lack of anxiety to prove his or her good breeding. In other words, this is a person who doesn't give a crap what people think of them. They do what they do, and they know that they do it well, which is so Harry. Harry, he told you what he thought, and he didn't really care what you thought. He was going to think it anyway, which is what made him so special. So anyway, I want to play this piece for him and for you. And again, this is Sprezzatura by Huss Janssen.
Thank you.
So thank you, Harry, for teaching me just about everything I know about the bass clarinet and for giving me the courage to make noises like that. These noises, by the way, got me kicked out of band in the 11th grade. I was experimenting with multiphonics, and my band director, who didn't really like me very much anyway, definitely didn't like that, and he gave me a C. So thank you, Harry, for making that C worthwhile. Let's talk a little bit about this piece and how you make these multiphonic sounds. What does multiphonic mean? Well, let's take the word apart.
Cat, cat,
phonic. Phonic means sound, right? Multi means many, many sounds. You've heard of monophonic, and the bass clarinet and the voice and the trumpet are all monophonic instruments. That means they play one note at a time. Pianos and guitars and cellos and violins and those sorts of instruments, harps, can play more than one note at a time. They're not called multiphonic instruments, they're called polyphonic instruments. But the bass clarinet, when you play more than one note at a time, it's called a multiphonic. So how do you take an instrument that's built to play one note at a time, play more than one note at a time? Now, we've talked about this in the past, but it bears repeating here since we have an example of a piece of music that uses it. Bass clarinet has been developed over the last several hundred years into the instrument that we have today. It's been engineered and re-engineered, and it's still under development. You know, it's kind of a cool thing is that the bass clarinet, even as old as it is still something that's being actively reinvented. As we speak, there are manufacturers who are figuring out new places to put the holes in the instrument and new keys to put on to make them more efficient, to play more in tune, etc. So when the designers built the bass clarinet, they decided that, at least in this particular case, this is the perfect place right here for the register key. Now the register key is what takes a note in the shallower register, the bottom register of the bass clarinet, and it brings it up a 12th. So a low G becomes a D. And an A becomes an E, and so on. So a 12th, unlike a saxophone, that key is called an octave key because why? It takes it up an octave. This is a register key because the bass clarinet is unique in that it goes up a 12th. And then when you get into the altissimo register, you start getting into the harmonic series, and I'm not going to get into that. But that is the perfect place for the register key for the bass clarinet to do what it is intended to do. There is no law that says that I have to use this as my register key. There is no bass clarinet police that is going to come and arrest me if I decide to use my A key as my register key, or if I decide to use one of my top two trill keys as my register key. Instead of getting that, what if I decide I want to use this side E flat key as my register key? Whoa. So it didn't give me any of the notes that I was expecting. It gave me this sort of kind of chord sounding thing. Let's listen to the notes in that chord. So this is a G, and I'm pushing the side E flat key. Do I get the G in that? Not really. I get a D. And I get a high B. I get mostly the D and the B, and then I get some other sort of grunge in there. But those two notes together are an octave plus a sixth, which is actually a nice sounding harmony. That's when I use this register key. What if I decide I want to use a different register key, like, oh, I don't know, my first finger here? That doesn't work. What if I decide I want to use the G sharp key? That doesn't really work either. So it's a lot of experimentation. So how do you know what notes to play when you're looking at a piece of music? Well, fortunately for this, the composer has given us a key. It shows us the fingerings, and when he uses the one right here for a trill, that means I'm supposed to move my thumb. A two is my first finger, a four is my third finger, etc., etc. And then when you look at the actual piece of music itself, there's a one, and a two. That allows me to move up through those different harmonic series on that held note. This is a complicated way to look at music. Don't worry about how you read this. This is just showing you how the composer does this. Now, what if you actually are wanting to compose a piece of music? Or if you see something in the composer wasn't as nice as to give you a fingering for it. Well, fortunately, there is this really terrific book that just came out by Sarah Watts called Spectral Immersions. It came out a couple of years ago. This book is insanely, insanely in-depth. What it really seems like is it's sort of like a doctoral thesis in the beginning explaining how multiphonics work and how she came across all of these fingerings, etc. But at the back of the book is the gold mine. She has all of the different multiphonics that you can make on the bass clarinet with their fingerings and the resulting sounds. And if that's not enough, she gives you a couple of CDs where you can actually hear them. This book is so fantastic. Sarah, thank you for making this for all of us, because otherwise I'd be ripping my hair out. So that is the theory of multiphonics. Now, Huss Jansen has taken it one step further, where not only do I play the multiphonic with that trill, is that I also have to use the inside of my mouth, my tongue in particular, to voice different notes inside that multiphonic so they pop out more than others. This is what that sounds like. All of that is done by going high. Yeah. inside my mouth. So I can't show you that, but that's all I'm doing. So, back to Harry. Harry, you're awesome. I'm going to miss you, and the world is going to miss you, and we all love you. Thank you so much for everything that you've done for the bass clarinet. I know you're up there. I know you're in here. And for the rest of us, if you don't know him, please, please go check out everything Harry has done. He is quite amazing, okay? So until next time, we'll see you.